coming to you live from downtown Bennington, Vermont, in Studio 1A. It's Outdoor Secrets Unwrapped with Chris Bates, Stephanie Calabro, and Jessica Lilly.
We need to take a quick break, and we're going to come back and talk to Jason Becthold from Vermont Fish and Wildlife right here at AM 1370 WBTN.
Show. It's great, right, Steph?
We love
that. With Jessica Lilly running the boards, making her phone calls, the feisty, spicy Stephanie Calabro. But we need to get to our guest because we have Youth Deer Weekend within a couple days here. And we have Colonel Jason Becthold. And, of course, he is the top guy. Hey, Jason, how are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Ah, thanks for being on. I love it. Sometimes our schedules just don't meet up. But we have the Youth Weekend, and we kind of want to know the do's and don'ts of this important weekend, because this is, I think, Steph and I were talking about how we either make or break somebody into really enjoying the outdoors and deer hunting.
Sure, yeah, I'm eager to get going here. And
fire away, no pun intended!
I think the do's far outweigh the don'ts in this instance, and I maybe I'll get into the don'ts first so we can concentrate on all the good stuff.
Yeah.
So this weekend that we're talking about is a special weekend that accompanied youths who are age 15 and under can go out with a licensed adult, 18 or over, and harvest a deer on one of those 2 days. And that deer can be a buck or a doe or a spike horn on this weekend, which isn't allowed currently on any other season that we have. Some of the higher points or some of the more pointed regulations that we have on this weekend are that everyone needs permission for the land that they're hunting on if it is private, and of course if it isn't your own land. So if it's private property, then unlike any other weekend that we have, you would need to have permission. It doesn't have to be written, but this is to make young people familiar with knocking on doors and becoming friendly with the
landowners. Right,
mm-hmm. That's something I think everybody can understand. It makes good neighbors. It makes no surprises. Everyone knows why they're there, and it makes a much more successful experience for everybody. Especially the kids, and even as importantly, the landowners here, because they're definitely the heroes. If there has to be a different hero than the kid who gets a deer.
Right, exactly.
Some questions that people ask about when we get into the finer details are, if I'm hunting my own property, so do I still need a license? And the answer is yes. So this weekend is a carve out, an exception to all other weekends when we do require a landowner to have a license to hunt their own property, and the kid has to have a license, albeit a free youth tag. We do require people to have that hunting license with them when normally they wouldn't need one to hunt their own property. Any questions about that one?
No, that makes sense to me. And I'm glad you brought that up, because a lot of times, you know, people, it's my land, I can do what I want, but not now, right?
Right. This weekend, and the best way for me to put it is that it's a special carve-out, and if people want to participate in it, these are the special rules for this weekend.
Right.
And, you know, they're welcome to call the office, and I talk about this with people almost every day.
Right.
There are no caliber restrictions. The regular hunting hours apply, so it's 1/2 hour before sunrise to 1/2 hour after sunset. And, again, it is for any deer. There's one thing that I like to plug, even though it's not a requirement, is the Hunter Orange this weekend.
Well, we just got done talking about that, wearing Hunter Orange. I believe it's a must, but, you know, again, who am I?
Well, you know, you're certainly spot on. I wear it every time I'm in the woods, with the exception of when I'm up in a tree stand for archery season.
Right.
But in these seasons, it just makes sense to let other hunters know where you are, for all the preventative sense that it makes. And it, you know, deer see in shades of gray and and lighter color, lighter gray and darker gray, and they're not going to see your hunter orange.
Exactly.
All the deer that I've shot have never seen my orange, and you know I'm no great hunter, but you know they certainly have had no issue with the orange that I've been wearing.
So Jason, they didn't say, "Hey, who's that guy wearing the orange vest?"
if they did, it was too late by then.
Yeah, they were already hearing the boom.
Yeah, exactly.
Nice.
And again, that's not a law, but it is one that makes sense, and it can be an added level of confidence for someone being in the woods
exactly
for the first time, right?
Yep, mm-hmm. Exactly. I'm all about safety.
Yeah, and it's a good habit to get these kids into.
It really is. It's something that a lot of states require, and thankfully Vermont, you know, does allow us the choice. But it's still worth mentioning that it makes a great deal of sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Something else that people do ask questions about is how close do I have to be to my mentee or the child that I am, or a young person that I am mentoring.
Right.
And so we basically want you to be in such distance so you would not have to use an electronic device or hearing aids or even binoculars to make sure you knew what this child was doing. Basically, I like to tell people, you know, be in the same blind with them or the same stand. That way there's mm-hmm. no question. We've had, unfortunately, cases where an adult will put a young person down and they'll do a push for them, or they'll do a short drive for them. That is unlawful, and so we don't ever want that youth to be left alone during this season.
No kidding.
Yeah, we don't allow that type of separation, and so that can get folks into trouble, and that's certainly not anything that we want to see on this weekend. This weekend is about having fun. And
exactly.
You certainly don't want to
go
crossways with any of the laws. And which brings me to, I guess we're not there yet. I want to make sure we cover all the relevant laws. And if you have questions, please go ahead.
So I do have one real quickly. You know, we'll jump ahead a little bit. After they harvest their deer and they go bring it to a check station, mm-hmm. Do the Fish and Wildlife officers, do they check licenses when they do that? Because how do you know or is it an honor system?
No, so you bring up a great point that I wrote down.
Oh, okay, sorry.
I brought up. No, it's fine. I was going to plug it at the end, but we do ask that, you know, you visit one of our biological check stations that we send biologists to certain stations over this weekend, so they can get the best biological data possible out of these deer.
Yeah,
it's a weekend that, you know, we usually don't get to measure spike horn antlers because they're not a legal take, but they are this weekend. And so the biologists love to take a tooth out of them and take an antler beam diameter measurement and a weight. And so they like to do this. And at that check station, yes, they will ask to see the licenses of both the adult and the youth.
Okay.
To correspond with, you know, everybody gets a participating a Vermont deer participation patch, which is a really neat thing. You can put it on your hunting coat.
Nice.
And the biologists aren't there to they're not law enforcement, and they're not encouraged to, you know, to step in any law enforcement capacity. So if you're lucky enough to see a game warden there on the weekend, maybe by some chance they're going to ask you for your license at the check station, but most of the time they're just going to be there to shake hands and say congratulations.
Oh, that's cool. Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah, it is. It's one of those. It's a great weekend for everybody because everybody wants to have everyone wants to have success.
That's right.
Everyone wants kids to enjoy it. Everyone wants everyone to have fun and be safe. Those are the main points that I like to touch on for Youth Weekend. And those are when I was a field warden, which I'm not anymore, but when I was a field warden, those were the main things that we enforced. And because there are, you know, every Youth Weekend or every time there's an event like this, we do, you know, there's the 99% of 0.9 of the hunters are doing everything right, and then there's always one instance where we do end up enforcing the law.
Yeah.
And it's not fun for anybody because the kids usually have no idea that something was done wrong, and usually it's not intentional. So these are wonderful outreach shows that you do. So yeah. I really appreciate the
opportunity. Yeah, exactly.
But I'd like to get into a little bit of the fun part, and we touched on it already. But this is a weekend that it brings. I'm a little bit jealous because it wasn't around when I was a kid. But this weekend is a time that people can bond. Whoever the mentor and the youth are, this is a weekend where they will, even if they don't have any success. I mean, how many chances do you get to sit in a blind and freeze your tail off with somebody else and laugh about it and drink coffee and soup and hot chocolate and just laugh and chat and maybe have a real opportunity to take home, 30 to 50 pounds of awesome meat.
Yep, exactly.
These are the high points that I like to touch on.
Yeah.
It's going to be cold. And so to get into the do's, I would tell people to dress in layers. And I haven't actually looked at the weather for this weekend, except for the fact that it's going to be really cold.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that for a successful hunt to happen on this weekend, you're going to want to likely be in a blind. If that's the way you like to hunt, that's going to be a way to block that wind from you. You're going to want to dress in layers, bring a lot of hand and toe warmers, because kids and even 15-year-old kids are susceptible to the cold, and they will have a much better experience if they're going to last longer in the stand or
right.
in the blind. And the wind's not cutting through their clothes, and they're not wet, they're dry, and they're comfortable, right? And,
exactly.
Yeah, and so I like to plug that, and I've got a son who's not going to be hunting this year, but next year we'd really want him to get into it, and so I'm thinking about these things for myself from that perspective, and I'm really excited to be able to have the chance to think about it here before the weekend.
Yeah.
Again, I talked about landowner permission, which is a must, but something that I like to encourage people to do after the hunt is to offer maybe a package of meat to the landowner after to kind of seal the deal and maybe get them a picture of the person or maybe a dinner that you made out of this deer. Landowners, we're still very lucky in Vermont where we've got a lot of private landowners that are very pro hunting, or either they may be on the fence, they don't really care one way or the other, but those types of interactions of even offering a little bit of deer meat or, hey, look what you did for my family type thing can open so many doors for hunters in the future. And to add to that, if you do knock on a door and you don't have any success finding a place to hunt, it doesn't hurt to say, hey, I'm not disappointed. I would have liked to have hunted here, but do you know anybody in the neighborhood that does allow hunting? And usually, one out of five times that you're going to have some success doing that. If you've already got a place to hunt, that's wonderful. But that's a good tip for people. Do you know anybody in the area that hunts and might allow this? Because, the youth hunters, they get to take one deer, and they're not going to be a threat to anyone's personal,
exactly.
collection of deer, right? And so I like to put that in people's minds that it's going to be a lot. It's going to do a lot more harm than good if you do allow this on your land.
That is a very good topic you brought up about asking for permission and knocking on doors, because in South Dakota, when you want to go bird hunting or coyote hunting out there or anything, all you got to do is walk up, knock on the door, and 98% of the time they are going to let you go out there because it's so big and so vast that they don't really care, But it's always, the people that don't ask and then they find them out there, that's when the trouble starts. So, mm-hmm. and you're right, in Vermont, I believe it's kind of a lost art because a lot of people want to go in the back door. If you just ask, I think it's a great thing.
Yeah, and it creates goodwill, and and you can have it for years to come if you play your cards right and you're nice and you treat the landowners with respect. Next year, they're
more
likely
to go.
To say
right.
yes.
Okay,
that's really well said. It's such a good point. There was a guy that took me out fishing when I lived while I was in the military, And he the first thing that we did, he gave me a trash bag, and we picked up trash along the riverbank. And I didn't know what we were doing. And then he said, well, this guy was lucky, nice enough to give us river access. And
yep.
So I'm going to show him the two bags of trash that we picked up. And, it was a really neat gesture. This guy couldn't believe the amount of trash that was along the riverbank near his house. This was in Virginia. It wasn't in Vermont. Anyway, it was a really neat gesture. And those are just simple things that you can do for people. But it's so well said. It's gonna make your time more fulfilling, and it's gonna show the landowner that you care more about the relationship than about anything else.
Exactly.
Right. And what a good lesson for kids to learn that from the get-go. You know, instead of
oh, absolutely.
Do you find, Jason? Do you find that the parents or the grandparents or uncles or whoever takes these kids out, do you find that they are all about doing it the right way and not cutting corners?
99.9% of the time, yes, they
yeah,
are.
Good, good.
They want, you know, they understand that this is an opportunity that they you know, they don't want to mess up, and B, that's going to for legal reasons, I think, because I think in the back of everybody's mind. Is they'd rather not, you know, have to see the game warden today,
right?
And then, even though we would love to see everybody and on a good note, but they also understand that they may only have a couple of years to get this right with their child or the person that they're mentoring, and get them hooked. You know, if you do it wrong, like last year, I don't envy those poor people on youth weekend last year. It was so bitter cold and it snowed and the deer weren't moving, and then it rained, and it was just awful.
Yeah.
And so some of those things you can't control, but some of the things you really can. And I think that across the landscape, our hunters are so respectful of the laws and the resource. Of course, we don't see that because we never write, you know, news articles about the
exactly.
wonderful law-abiding guy. All we see are the poor schmoes that you know go crossways with the law, and everyone, you know,
yep.
has to make an example out of them. But you know, there is good in that at times to show why you don't want to mess up. But I think that if you could quantify that, you'd have a lot more news about the folks that did things right than about the things they do wrong.
So I read this earlier in the show. This is coming out of my home state of Illinois. Okay, so. Yeah. Through Sunday, November 3rd, right, the Illinois archery deer hunters harvested a preliminary total of 27,635 deer already.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. You know, there's like 1.7 million deer in that state.
Isn't that unbelievable?
Yeah. So maybe Vermont will be like that someday.
Boy, I hope so. You know, the way the deer biologist is running things now, he's thinking ahead to a time when we're going to have a lot more deer and, you know, probably a few less hunters. And there will be a time for that type of harvest, you know,
yep.
you know, keeping the herd healthy is his mission. And he's doing it a fine job. You know, I'm just thinking ahead to next year when the limit is going to go up by one.
I think that's the greatest thing ever.
Yep. I do too. I do too. And
yep.
I, you know, he's a very educated, very thoughtful guy, and he's doing this for the hunters and for the herd. And there are, you know, a few bones to be picked along the way that people are picking, believe me.
Of course.
It's all in the interest of hunters and the herd and the health of the herd. So.
Right, right. All right. Well, you were very informative, my friend. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you so much.
It was my pleasure. I'd love to do it anytime you need.
Okay, we'll have to get you back on at some point for something else next, okay?
Sounds great. Well, good luck to everybody out there, and if you need something, call Warden.
Okay, thanks, Jason. We'll talk to you.
Yep. Take care. Bye-bye now.
Okay, bye-bye.
See, that cleared up a lot of stuff for me, you know? It really did. And I'm glad to hear, I am so glad to hear that the mentors spend the time with the kids.
Yeah, well, we did a show several years ago at the Deer Station when the
over at Marty's yeah,
on
we
Youth
did a
Weekend,
show. Yep.
And boy, you know, you see those kids come, and they are so proud, and they are standing there, and they're they're doing their rituals for the first time. You know, they're getting their deer, they're checking it in, they're talking to the biologist, their families are all there.
Yeah, exactly.
So proud. Their grandmothers, their grandfathers, their great grandmothers and grandfathers.
I think we saw, Jessica, didn't your daughter?
No, our niece.
Your
Sierra.
Niece harvested a deer.
She's gotten two, I believe. So
yeah.
Far.
Yeah. I remember that.
It's so it's just, it's so exciting to watch them and to know it's if they do get a deer, it's a great sense of pride that they're going to have this weekend. And if they don't, well, maybe it was a good bonding experience,
right.
And because you don't always get one. You got to learn about disappointment, too.
All right.
You know?
Well, we need to take a break. All right, folks, we're going to be back with more right after this at AM 1370 WBTN. With
you again. May God bless you. Adios. Wise men say, only fools rush in. But I can't.